What's up, family? It is Kaden with Urban Finance. In this video, we'll discuss how to save your first $200,000. We'll also be taking a look at our investment portfolio. Now, if you're new to this channel, I talk about everything related to financial literacy, investing, and building generational wealth. So if you haven't already, go ahead and smash that like button, subscribe to the page, and hit the bell to be notified of when I post something new. And if you want to get two free stocks valued up to about $1,400, feel free to sign up with Webull with the link in the description. All right, let's jump in. So I'm going to break down our saving accounts, or how we use our savings and our investment portfolio, because that's how really we build our wealth. If you have any questions at all during the video, just let me know in the comment section below. So anyone that knows me knows that it's hard to get an item in my budget after it's already created. And so we create a budget for the entire year, as well as a zero-based budget. We also create a line for miscellaneous expenses. But once those miscellaneous expenses line is done, that's it. I am broke from there, regardless to how much money I have sitting in my bank account. And that's really one strategy that you can use in order to save and build wealth. Create your budget and stick to it. And when those lines run out, you're broke, at least until you save that first $100,000, because that's truly the hardest $100,000, and your money start compounding after that. So you don't have to be as stringent after that, but obviously the more strict you are with your budget, the more you'll be able to save, invest, and grow your wealth. So currently we probably have a little over $38,000 saved in cash. About $27,000 is our 6 months emergency fund. You can usually have a 3 to 6 months emergency fund. I probably gravitate more to the 3 months emergency fund, and my wife gravitates more to the 6 months emergency fund. And a general rule of thumb for saving together or investing together is that you go with the person with the higher threshold or need for security, which is 6 months in this case. And if marriage has taught me anything, it's probably wise to listen to your wife. Also, every month we save a little bit in order to pay Uncle Sam. Our tax bill can be as much as $10,000. I have no idea what it will be this year because I have a son now, and maybe that will help out a little bit. We shall see. But we also make sure to try to put aside an extra $10,000 just in case the IRS hits us with a very high tax bill. So right now we have about $187,000 saved in our investment accounts, and our target goal each year is to save $100,000 a year. Our first few years of marriage, we will focus on buying our home, focus on paying off debt. But now that we have done all of those stuff, our primary goal for investing is at least $100,000 each year. And you'll see that we're on track to do that this year. So from January to February, our investments grow at about a little over $9,300. From February to March, it grew a little over $11,000. And actually at the peak in February, it was up almost about $19,000, and the market gives and the market takes away. So we ended up with a little over $11,000, and I am hoping for a better March. I'm hoping for a $15,000 growth, but we will see what happens. So between our cash and savings, we have about $226,000, both in our savings and investments. So one of the big secrets for us to save that first $200,000 is really focus in on low cost index funds for investing. So out of the $187,000, almost $150,000 of it is invested in the S&P 500 index. And if you don't know, the S&P 500 index is a low cost market capitalization index that tracks essentially the 500 largest companies: Microsoft, Amazon, Tesla, Johnson & Johnson, you get the drift. But last year, in 2020, the S&P 500 index returned a total of about 19%, and in 2019, the S&P 500 returned a total of 31%. And so some people feel like they would never get a really good return from the S&P 500 index, but that's just not true. So if you can be consistent about adding into the S&P 500 index, you can build some serious wealth. For example, Vanguard's S&P 500 index charge an expense ratio of 0.04%. So for example, if you had $100,000 invested in there, you will pay about $40 a year. On the other hand, hand, our KETF, which I am also invested in, charts an expense ratio of 0.75. So if you had $100,000 invested in that, you will pay $750 a year, which is a huge difference. Now, obviously, you're expecting a greater return from ARK ETF, and that's why you are paying that premium. But that just gives you an example of how much of a difference these expense ratio means for your dollars. So we have another $20,000 invested in various mutual funds, and these were mutual funds that we pick up before we started putting most, if not all, of our retirement funds in the S&P 500 index. And so some of them are international indexes and things of that nature. But now most, if not all, of our retirement money goes into the S&P 500 index. Then we have another $17,000 that is invested in high growth ETFs, as well as single stocks. We have Vanguard's VGT Technology ETFs, we have YOLO ETF, we have THCX ETFs, we own ARK, ARG, and ARKF. We also own IRBO, which is an artificial intelligence ETF. And then our top three stocks for single holdings is Apple, Simon Property Group, and Aphria. So as I said, I truly believe that most of your money should go into low-cost index funds. And even in the volatility that our accounts had this year, where we see the difference of the $12,000 return compared to almost the $19,000 return that we could have had, a lot of the fluctuation happens within our single stocks, and some of it within our ETFs as well, but a lot of it happened within our single stocks. And that just goes to show, when you're building long-term wealth, I would personally take stability over high risk. So sum up the video, when you're trying to save that first $200,000, there's really three levers that will make the most difference. The first one is getting a side hustle or a second job, so increasing your income somehow. The second one is making the necessary sacrifices, so cutting back on your lifestyle. That may mean selling your car, that may mean not going on vacations, that may mean not going out. And this, again, could just be for your first $100,000. It doesn't have to be for the entirety of your life. And the third lever I think that each and every person could potentially pull is making smart investment decisions. And for me, those smart investment decisions are first investing in low-cost ETFs, and then above that, with additional cash outside of retirement, potentially investing in more volatile, risky investments if you have the capital for it. All right, family, I hope you found this video to be informative. If you have any questions at all, let me know in the comment section. If you haven't already, please smash that like button, subscribe to the page, and hit the bell to be notified of when I post something new. And like I always say, even in the midst of these crazy times, God bless you, and remember to live your best life.